For the next couple of chapters, we'll be looking at the physics of astronomy. Our first major topic here is motion and its relationship to forces and energy.
In the middle of the 1600s, the people who studied nature, they called themselves natural philosophers at that time, they had a problem. The invention of the telescope had given good evidence that Earth was a spinning planet orbiting around the sun. But you couldn't feel the Earth moving, so something must be wrong. It was obvious that a new understanding of motion was needed.
This new understanding started with a new question. Usually when people ask about motion, they ask about what makes things move. However, around this time, natural philosophers started realizing that the really interesting question might be, what makes things stop? So in this chapter, we'll start out by looking at ways of describing motion based on forces. This comes from Newton's laws of motion.
Then we'll move on to a different understanding of motion, provided by looking at energy. Depending on what you're doing, either forces or energy can be a very effective way of understanding motion.
After this, we'll focus more specifically on the force of gravity and how it allows us to understand orbits. And finally, we'll look at another application of gravity as the cause of tides. If we're going to talk about motion, we first have to define our terms. Here we learn a little bit about the culture of science. In some branches of science, biology, for instance, it's normal that when someone wants to give a name to something, they pull out their Latin or their Greek dictionary, or if they're feeling creative, maybe both, and use that to invent a whole new word. This makes the vocabulary section of biology textbooks huge, but it's typically not how things are done in the physical sciences. Instead, folks in physics and astronomy often use very common words to describe terms, but they give them very specific definitions that may not exactly match how those words are used day to day. So you need to make sure you know the physicist's definition of these terms, not just the way you might use them in everyday life.
The first term we need to define is speed. We've already talked about this one. Speed is the distance something travels divided by the time it travels. The units will be distance over time, such as meters per second. There's nothing very unusual here.
Velocity is both speed and direction. In other words, with the velocity, you need to know not just how fast something is going, but also in what direction. If you say you're going 65 miles per hour, you're talking about your speed. If you say you're going 65 miles per hour eastbound, you're talking about your velocity.
This distinction really starts to matter with the next term, acceleration. Acceleration is the change in velocity. Since the units of velocity are distance over time, the units of acceleration are distance over time divided by time, or distance divided by time squared. An example would be meters per second, or meters per second squared. Any change in velocity is an acceleration. If you speed up, you're accelerating. If you slow down, you're accelerating. And even if you just turn a corner without changing your speed at all, you're still accelerating.
The formula that describes this is delta V equals A times T. The triangle at the start is the Greek letter delta. And in math, this symbol generally means change. So delta V means how much the velocity changes. A is the acceleration, and T is the time. A good example of accelerating is a falling body. When something falls, it has an acceleration of almost 10 meters per second squared. So if you drop something and it takes 3 seconds to reach the ground, it will be moving at 3 times 10, or 30 meters per second by the time it hits. So now we can start looking at Newton's laws of motion. Newton's laws are really a way of describing motion. As I mentioned earlier, Newton's laws describe motion in terms of forces. They let you relate how a force of a given size produces a certain change in a body's motion.
Newton didn't invent all of these laws himself. Some of the thinking behind his first law goes back at least to Galileo, several decades earlier. However, he did put them all together into a complete picture of forces and motion that many people regard as the starting point for physics as we know it.
Also, once you get started thinking this way, it's really easy to see Newton's laws at work. They really do explain our everyday experience. In effect, a baby just learning to move around is really learning Newton's laws of motion. But as I said earlier, Newton's laws start with a surprising question. Why do things stop moving? Let's look at Newton's first law of motion. This is sometimes called the law of inertia. It says that a body remains at rest or moves in a straight line at a constant speed unless acted on by a net outside force. Okay, let's pull this apart and see if we can figure out what it means. First, notice that this is the no net force situation. We'll look at this more closely in a minute, but keep in mind that it says that all of the forces are balanced. Also, the first law says that the motion isn't changing. If something is at rest, it stays that way. If it's moving along at a constant velocity, it stays that way. In other words, there is a resistance to change. We call this resistance inertia. Then you come to the unless. So the motion doesn't change unless there is a net force. So let's look at this idea of a net force.
Watch out. Here comes Bruce. He's here to remind us that this is the part of Newton's laws that people most often get wrong. We're often tempted to say that if something keeps on moving, you have to keep a force on it. But this says, no, that's not true. We'll see why we have that misconception in a few minutes.
Let's look at forces. A force is any push or pull on an object. Force is directional. The direction you push makes a difference on how something moves. It also means that if you're pushing on something up or down, that doesn't change its motion from side to side. What about net force? That's just the difference between all the forces pushing in one direction versus all the forces in the opposite direction. For example, forwards versus backwards. So if we say there is no net force, then we mean that all of those forces add up to zero. There's the same amount of force forwards as backwards. Okay, what Newton is saying here is that if the forces on a body are equal, then it keeps moving in a straight line at a constant speed. Another way of saying this is that if you are going at a constant speed and direction, it feels like you're standing still. Imagine sitting in an airplane, traveling at hundreds of miles per hour. If it weren't for the vibration of the engines, you might not notice that you are moving at all.
But what about our day-to-day experience, that you do have to keep pushing on things to keep them moving? The reason for that is simple. The moving bodies we experience on the Earth have to deal with another force, the force of friction, or else with related forces like air resistance. Every time an object is moving, these frictional forces are pushing on it to slow it down. When you push on something to keep it going, all you're really doing is balancing out the force of friction.
There's effectively no friction for something moving through space. As a result, once you push on something, it tends to keep going indefinitely. That spacecraft that just went past is one of the Voyager spacecraft. They were launched back in 1977, and since then, their rockets have hardly fired, yet they've traveled farther than any other object humans have ever made, several times the distance to the farthest planets in our solar system, and they're still going.